Thanks, Keith.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Jesus.
I always just, I love when Keith does worship at Sevier Valley, and I'm pleased as punch, and he's doing it here too. But is this like, you know, that's worship.
Yeah.
And not saying that our worship team doesn't do it, because we do. That's something that we want to be a worshiping church. I said that on day one.
Yeah.
And I think we're well on our way down that, down on that path.
Thank you.
All right. So, one thing I learned over the years of the ministry is that ministry never starts instantly. Okay? Despite what some people may think or say, one never walks into the job cold. There's always some type of preparation required, and the Lord always provides that preparation. It may take a few weeks, it may take a few months, it may even take years, which is more likely and was the case for Alicia and I before we came up here. And even when we feel, and here's the funny thing, you may have noticed this, when we feel that we're ready for it, we aren't. It's a darn good sign that no, you aren't. And it's kind of funny that when we don't feel like we're ready, the Lord's saying, oh yes, you are. Boop, out you go.
Yes.
So he knows when we're ready. He knows ourselves better than we know ourselves. And that's scary sometimes, but it's also very comforting. Because when it's time for ministry, we want to be ready. We want to do what he wants us to do and not try to sit there and ab lib it the whole time. It's ready or not, here we go. And usually we're ready. Now, we saw last week, I mentioned this, because last week even Jesus needed to be prepared for his upcoming ministry. And that was the whole point of the 40-day sojourn in the wilderness. It was directed by the Holy Spirit and included various temptations from Satan. Now, to be honest, I don't think Jesus did it for fun. We kind of talked over what happens when you don't eat for 40 days. It's definitely not a pleasant experience. And he wasn't trying to do it to prove that he was a more manly, rugged guy than John the Baptist. Okay? Had nothing to do with it. The temptations, especially, allowed Jesus to connect with man as a whole. Remember, Jesus was fully man, fully God. And it wasn't that he didn't know what temptation was like, because God knows everything. But in the physical body, he still had to feel that pull, that push. And as a man, it connected him with the rest of the human race. And he had his strengths and he had his weaknesses. Let's face it, he was hungry. Later on, he was tired. He had to have the angels basically minister to him, and I will probably say to resuscitate him back to where he should be. Okay? And you know, that's not blasphemous, because the Bible makes it clear, he suffered just like anybody else. You read through the Gospels, he got tired, he would fall asleep. He would, you know, he'd be upset about something. He wept tears of sorrow over the people of Israel. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he sweat blood, okay? Or actually, it was sweat like blood. Of course, when we get to that point, Dr. Luke's going to kind of tell us a little bit more about that. He suffered from that type of thing. Even some people will say we should never pray more than once over something. That's lack of faith. Why are you telling me Jesus lacked faith in the garden? How many times did he pray?
Three times.
Okay, was he lacking faith? No. But it showed he didn't want to get crucified. He knew he was going to get flogged and crucified. That's why he said, Lord, if there's any way we can get around this, let's do it, but your will be done. I'd like to just pass on the whole if it's possible, but if not, Lord, let's do it. Let's get this over with. So he had to be prepared for ministry during this 40-day period. And as we continue now on in Luke 4, and then while you're there, go ahead and open up to chapter 4, verse 14. He's now recovered from his ordeal in the desert, and he's now starting his earthly ministry. Now that everything is ready, he's on his way. So Luke chapter 4, starting in verse 14. As I hear the Bible still turning to that point. It's a nice sound. Even though I'm more electronically. What I think they should do is they have little special effects of when you're turning the pages of your federal Bible. So honestly, I think I turned off because it irritated me. Not that I don't like the sound of turning pages in the Bible, it's not necessary on an iPad. So here we are. Verse 14, then Jesus returned to the power in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out through all the surrounding region, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So this is a very short and simple summary and assessment of Jesus' early ministry. It's interesting, Luke doesn't really give us any details other than he was led to Galilee by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that he was very well known throughout that entire area. He was highly respected as a teacher, and he went to all the different synagogues, and everyone was saying, wow, yeah, you can come here and we'll have you give the sermon. Now, it's interesting that the Gospel of John kind of goes into a lot more detail. During this time that Luke uses two verses, John goes over about four chapters. Okay, this is when Jesus was gathering disciples. This is when he turned water into wine at the wedding in Cana. This is when he drove the money changers out of the temple for the first time. This is when he had his little evening chat with Nicodemus, when he talked with the Samaritan woman at the well, and when he healed a nobleman's son. Okay, now so we know what happened, thanks to John. Okay, so no wonder he had a lot of notoriety. Then we go back to Luke. It's like, no wonder he is well known, because he was doing all these great things. Now, again, there's a question that crops up. You know, why did Luke pass over all these events while John goes into detail? Well, a lot of people will sit there and say, see, there are contradictions here. And we've already talked about that. Just because it's not mentioned, it doesn't make it a contradiction. Somebody, it was kind of interesting that someone who was an expert in forensic science looked at all four Gospels, because they do come from different points of view. And he said that the thing that makes the Gospels most likely to be true is because they don't 100% agree. See, as a forensic investigator, he says when you've got five or six different stories that agree 100%, that indicates collusion of some type. Let's get our story straight. And here, this is the gospel message, if we're dealing with a court case, is more admissible than seven people who are basically saying the exact same thing with no variation whatsoever. And let's face it, Luke didn't claim he was giving an exhaustive biography of every single thing that Jesus did. John tells us there wouldn't be enough room in the books to talk about every single thing that Jesus did. Okay, and John was the one that went into more detail. We also have to remember that each of the Gospels had its own viewpoint. They were addressing a different audience. Okay, for example, the book of Matthew was dealing with the fact that Jesus was the promised Messiah, was the son of David. Okay, a lot of emphasis on that. Luke, on the other hand, he was basically writing to a Gentile audience. And a lot of what he was putting down wouldn't make sense to Gentiles. They're wanting facts, they're wanting historically, you know, that's why he goes into so much history to try to pinpoint times. This is important to a Gentile. And he's not gonna sit there and worry too much about events that were really, really important to Jews, but kind of meaningless to a Gentile. For example, throwing out the money changers. Big deal in Judaism, okay? Yeah, these guys were defiling the temple. To a Gentile, well, that's business as usual. Okay, you throw them out, so what? You know, to them, it wasn't that big of a deal. Oh, it was a dramatic scene. Okay, I'm sure it was. Okay, got Jesus in there with his little whip, you know, swinging it around, snorting fire, getting everybody out of there. And you know, people are running and screaming and howling, and tables are overturning. I mean, when we think of the meek and mild Jesus, we don't think of someone tipping tables over and kicking people out and whipping them in the process. Okay, but into a Jew, this was important. And then Mark also was dealing with it, was talking to a Gentile audience. This is the shortest of the Gospels, but John's was written a long time later, almost 50 years after the other three Gospels were put together, and had an even third purpose. He was talking to a bunch of second and third generation believers, okay, who did not see what happened. Okay? They were far removed from these events. But you had heretics coming in particular Gnostics, who were stating that Jesus was not all man and not all God. You know, we don't have time to go into Gnosticism right now. We'll have plenty of opportunities, though, before we're done here. That basically it was confusing, it was muddying the waters, and John basically said, no, God, you know, Jesus was all God. That's why he went into so much detail about John, about Jesus' miracles. But he was also all man, because we see the motives behind the miracles. John does an excellent job in deconstructing Jesus as a special person, as opposed to just a historical figure. Okay, that's why a lot of people suggest you read, when you're a new believer, the first book in the Bible you read is the book of John. A lot of people suggest that. It's a great idea, because it does really get into who Jesus really was in a way that the other Gospels don't. Not that the other Gospels are bad, it's just they do it in a different way. So, enough said about that. No, there's no contradiction, it's just different emphasis. So let's move on now to verse 16. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" Stop there for a minute. All right, so by now, the news had spread far and wide about Jesus, the miracle worker from Nazareth. And so naturally, in his hometown, his family, friends, and neighbors were anxious to see and hear them. They hear all about, "Oh, Jesus, the carpenter's son, wow." And they're sitting there thinking, "Wait a minute, he's Joseph's kid, you know, Joseph and Mary." And to be honest, John mentions at this point, does not mention Joseph at all. Okay, just Mary and Jesus' brother. So it's not too much of a stretch to assume that Joseph was probably dead at this point. Okay. In modern eras, they might say, well, maybe he divorced Mary. No, we know that he had his opportunity long before this.
Yes.
No. And he was probably quite a bit older than Mary, and something may have happened. I mean, those days, get sick with something, die in short order. All we know is that they still identified him as Joseph's son. And they're quite surprised. They're sitting there, well, wait a minute, how did he get so religious? Where did he get his training from? And we don't understand who this is. So when he finally shows up, it's like, cool, we get to see the celebrity firsthand. Hey, local boy makes good. Now he's home and we get to hear him. One thing I do will have to mention, though, about Joseph before we move on. Whatever happened to him, if he died or whatever, he was definitely a good father figure for Jesus.
Yes.
Because he taught Jesus, as well as the rest of the kids, to be good and faithful Jews. We saw that back in chapter 2 when they went to the temple for Passover. Okay, that Jesus, you know, came, went along for the ride, and they went every year. Luke says they went every single year. And it says even here it was Jesus' custom to attend public worship, which means that he probably did so since he was old enough to be doing on his own, which would be about 12 or 13 years of age. And most scholars figure at this point he was about 30. So most of his life he was already a synagogue goer. Okay, that was his custom. And we know this is traced back to Joseph's example and to his teaching. He was a good father. A lot of times we forget about Joseph. We don't think much of him. And true, the Bible doesn't say a lot about him. But it says a little bit more than we think or are willing to look at. Okay? Jesus honored his earthly father. He continued the custom. He went to the synagogue every Sabbath. Now, Jesus could have argued that the religious system was corrupt, or that he didn't have to go because he didn't need the instruction. Remember when he was 12, he was instructing some of the people at the temple. So he really had a lot of excuses, a lot of reasons. Forget excuses, there are reasons. He didn't have to go, but he continued to go every single day. That was to model for everybody. Not to forsake the gathering in church, not just fellowship, but worship and study. Okay? It is a place of prayer. And he, if nobody else in the Bible, demonstrates prayer to the extreme. So let's look at the typical synagogue service. Okay, so here's Jesus. He was the guest rabbi today. Okay, you know he was asked to do it. Now, in a typical synagogue service, they open with prayer and invocation, and then they recited the Shema. Okay, you've probably heard of this. It's the traditional Hebrew confession of faith, and it's found in Deuteronomy 6. I'll read it to you. You don't have to turn there. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Okay. Every synagogue service started with that confession of faith. Then this was followed by a prayer, and then there were certain readings from the law and from the prophets. It's interesting how they mentioned the books. They weren't books as we know it, they were scrolls. Okay. So when they opened up the scroll, basically they had an attendant. I know this because even today at modern synagogues, and I had several Jewish students in my time as a teacher, and they would describe when they were the attendant, they were allowed to be the attendant. It was very exciting. You had to lift this big old scroll, even today, and you had to put it there and put it down, and then you had to slowly open it, and then as you moved one side, you had to open the other side to get to the point you were supposed to read from. And it wasn't one of those things where you were careless with it. You touched it carefully, you handled it carefully. If it, for example, unrolled and dropped on the floor, everything stopped at that point, that scroll had to be purified. Okay, so you were very careful with it. And then the reader would read the type of scripture. It was in Hebrew. Most people at that time spoke a language similar to Hebrew called Aramaic, but not quite the same. So the reader would paraphrase it. He'd read it out, and then he'd paraphrase kind of what he was saying. And then this was followed by a brief sermon, either given by one of the men of the congregation, or in the case of Jesus, a visiting rabbi. Okay, sometimes the fellow who was reading was the person who was going to give the sermon. Then if a priest was present, the service would close with a benediction. Otherwise, someone in the group would pray, and the meeting was dismissed. It may last about hour, 45 minutes. Wasn't very long. So here's Jesus. He's the guest speaker. They hand him the text. It was out of the book of Isaiah. And the book of Isaiah was one of the largest scrolls. Okay, so they probably had already set it up where it was supposed to be. He unrolls it, and what he reads, and we read it already, was from Isaiah 61, 1 through 2. That was his text. And everyone who knew about that part of scripture knew that this passage referred to the Messiah.
Yes.
Okay, so every single person in that room knew when Jesus was reading about it, he was talking about the Messiah. So you can imagine kind of how shocked and dismayed they were when Jesus basically says, yeah, this was written about me. Here I am. Ta-da! You know, it's like, here it is. And he was here, and he had come to usher in the acceptable year of the Lord.
Okay.
Let's look at that statement for another second. That reference refers to the year of Jubilee. Okay, it's described in Leviticus 25. Now, kind of ramp up to this point. This is what was supposed to happen. Unfortunately, it rarely did. Every seventh year was a sabbatical year for Israel. Okay, from the moment they got into the land, every 7 years they were supposed to just basically let the land rest. You weren't supposed to plow, you weren't supposed to plant seed, you weren't supposed to grow crops or anything like that. You were supposed to let the land rest, and the Lord would provide what was needed. And it was basically a step of faith. So you can understand, doesn't mean it was right, you can understand why people didn't do it. But wait a minute, we have to eat. How are we supposed to eat if every 7 years we can't grow anything? And so they just kind of ignored it and kept going. Okay? Then, after seven of those sabbaticals, it gets even better, was the year of Jubilee. And this was basically a balancing of the economic system at that point. On the year of Jubilee, it was usually after the seventh Sabbath, so that's 49 years, this was the 50th year. And again, it was another sabbatical year. The Lord was going to take care of them. But in addition, they were supposed to set slaves free. They were returned to their families. Property that was sold was reverted to the original owners. Okay, in the villages, in the fields, not in the villages. Okay, and all debts were either canceled or the terms were fulfilled at that point. Like you had a five-year chariot loan. Okay, in theory, when you hit that at the end of that loan, it's now paid off, and there was a little extra. The lender was supposed to basically say, you're good. It wasn't time for a deadbeat to suddenly go out there and make tons of loans and say, oh, it's 50 years, you gotta forgive them all. That was not the intent, okay? It wasn't meant to be taken advantage of, but even this rarely happened, okay? In fact, one of the reasons why Israel was conquered by Babylon and they stayed 70 years in captivity was because over the 490 years they were in the land, there were no Sabbaths. So God said, okay, it's going to rest for 70 years, which is what indeed happened. So Jesus is saying, I'm here to bring in this acceptable year, this year of Jubilee, but he wasn't doing it in a political or economic sense, but in a spiritual sense. He had brought good news. If you look through that passage he quoted, he certainly brought good news of salvation to bankrupt sinners, okay? And healing to the brokenhearted. And to those who were rejected, he gave hope. He had delivered many from blindness. Now, we see that more in John than we see in Luke, but he healed people. He delivered many from blindness, from leprosy, from the bondage of demons, different diseases. It was a spiritual jubilee. And the nation of Israel was benefiting from it now. But there was a problem. His listeners would not believe it. And he knew it. I mean, he heard the murmuring. They're saying, this is Joseph's kid, right? What's he talking about? Him being the Messiah? What's gotten into him? Is there something wrong? And being Jesus, he knew their thoughts. So he answered them. Instead of letting someone shout and say something, he just merely went on with a sermon. Verse 23, he said to him, you will surely say this proverb to me. Physician, heal yourself. Whatever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your country. And he said, assuredly I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all the land, but to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel at the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. So all of those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath, and they rose up and thrust him out of the city. And they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went his way. Well, so much for the closing prayer. It turned into a riot. Yeah, it's interesting. At first they admired the way he taught, but it didn't take long for their admiration to turn into antagonism. Jesus was reminding them of God's goodness to the Gentiles.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to be reminded of that. It's one of those things, yeah, we hear it as a story, but you have to look at the import of what is being said. Yeah, you are my people, but you have a purpose. You are a light to the rest of the world. So the way of salvation comes through you. No, you are not the way of salvation. The way comes through you. They didn't hear that last part. They didn't want to hear that last part. There's a fascinating quote by Augustine. He's a church, a church father. They love truth when it enlightens them, but hate truth when it accuses them.
Hmm.
Interesting. Right on the money right there. And he's right, you know. Basically, Jesus is telling them, look, yeah, there's all these widows around in Israel, but where he goes? He goes to this Sidonian woman who's a Gentile. Elijah does, and he helps her. Why not anybody else? And Elisha, you had, you know, the story of Naaman, you know, this general out of Syria. He comes down and he's healed. He's a leper and he's healed. Why weren't other lepers healed in Israel at that time? The Lord was saying, this shows God's grace.
Yeah.
The grace of God. But what their attitude was, that no, we are the Jews. We are the exclusive ones. We are the ones that matter. All those Gentiles, they're feeding the fires of hell. That's their purpose. And Jesus is basically saying, no, that's not the case. So they had a riot, basically. They saw him as the son of Mary, and they watched him grow up, and now he's, you know, oh, he was supposedly this faithful Jew. He goes to synagogue every Saturday, and now he's saying that Jews had to be saved by grace just like the Gentiles were? Is that what you're telling us? Wait a minute. When he says that, saying, you know, physician, heal thyself, they're saying, we were expecting you to do some miracle for us. And Jesus says, no. You don't deserve it. Congregation was so angry, they took him out. They wanted to kill him. And Jesus said, go ahead, take me out there. And then somehow, some way, we don't know how, he just went through the crowd, went his merry way, and they're sitting there probably just screaming, howling, and it's like, okay, let's push him over. Where'd he go? Did you see him? No, no, Dad. I thought you had him. You know? Okay, well, what are we doing here? I don't want to stand here. Okay, then it broke apart, but off goes Jesus. Okay. He wasn't going to spend any more time there. He really didn't care at that point. If they're going to reject him, he's just saying, fine, your day will come. Okay. He also knew that many would eventually come to repentance, but just not today. So in spite of the unbelief of the people in Nazareth, the scriptures declare that Jesus of Nazareth was God's son, was the promised Messiah sent to fulfill his promises. And the people who did not want him, who rejected the acceptable year of the Lord, one day, and this includes even today, those that reject the message of Christ, that he saves, they'll sit there and say, no, I don't need Jesus, I can do it my way, or I've got that special relationship with the guy upstairs, I don't need to do that kind of thing. One day they're going to face, instead of the acceptable year of the Lord, the year of Jubilee, the freedom from slavery of sin, they're going to face the wrath of God. And it was interesting, if Jesus had read a little bit further, he would have addressed that very issue. So despite their best efforts to kill him, he just went on. He found his way, he went back to Capernaum. So let's continue on in verse 31. He went down to Capernaum, a city in Galilee, and was teaching them on the Sabbaths. And they were astonished at his teaching, for his word was with authority. Now in the synagogue there was a man who had a spirit of an evil or of an unclean demon. And he cried out with a loud voice, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked him, saying, be quiet and come out of him. And when the demon had thrown them in their midst, it came out of him and did not hurt him. Then they were all amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, what a word this is. For the authority and for with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out. And the report about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. Now Capernaum, just to give you a little bit of a geography lesson, was a fishing village located along the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. If you have a map on your, in the back of your Bible, you will see the location close to where the Jordan River goes into the Sea of Galilee. And here's another little tidbit. It was the hometown of Peter, Andrew, James, and John, who were Jesus' disciples. So Jesus taught regularly in the synagogue there, and people were frankly astonished at, by his authority of his message. Of course, he's God. He knows the law. He knows what to preach. He doesn't even have to study for it. Okay? He's right there. And then, this was a big one, they were further astonished by the fact that he was able to command demons to leave people. Okay? Demon possession, and this is something that I found just through my studies of the scripture, was a very common thing in this time. Okay, we're going to see not just Jesus throwing out demons, but you know, the disciples trying to do it and doing it, and even Paul was dealing with it. So, what exactly are demons? Since we're here, let's kind of talk about it. Well, they're quite simply fallen angels. We read that after Satan, or at the time he was known as Lucifer, rebelled against God, okay, and in fact, we can see that in Isaiah 14, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations, for you have said in your heart, and this is the source of Lucifer's fall,
yes,
I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will sit, also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Okay? So this was the hint. Now, we, as you read through scripture, Lucifer was basically in charge of the worship of heaven. Okay? And pride came into his heart. Maybe he's thinking, I can run this show better than God can. And, yeah, that's a very dangerous thought. But then he started talking to others. And he managed to convince a third of the angels to basically rebel against God. And that rebellion is actually described in, we're not going to read that too much, in the, get up there, in the book of Revelation, chapter 12, okay, where the dragon is cast down from heaven, taking a third of the stars with him. The stars represent the angels. And when they came down to earth out of heaven, okay, they immediately established their dominion as much as they could. A lot of the demons were locked in darkness, bound with everlasting chains. This is from the book of Jude, verse 6. For some sin that they committed, okay, but others were allowed to roam free. And they're still around. They're referred to by different terms, the powers of this dark world, the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And their job is to try to thwart God's plan of salvation and hinder God's people. Okay? Even as far as trying to block messages from God to his servants. A good example of that is in the book of Daniel. Daniel was praying for an interpretation to a dream. And after 20 days, suddenly an angel appears and says, hey, sorry I'm late, but I got into battle with a demon, the prince of the kingdom of Persia, okay? Which gives us a hint, too, that each country has a demon, okay? And I would even not hesitate to say a demon in charge. If you look at a lot of these countries, you know it's like, okay, God didn't allow that to happen, okay? That was a demon in charge. And that they can and will fight against the angels and cause a little delay and so forth. But they are enemies coming from a position of defeat. Okay? I want to warn people right now, never underestimate demons. Never underestimate the power of Satan. But don't overestimate it either. Okay?
Amen.
Satan and the demons have lost the war.
Amen.
At the cross, at the resurrection, they were defeated.
Amen.
And they want to keep that secret from everybody. Exactly. Unfortunately, there's a lot of people who are extremely frightened about demons. And I'm not talking unbelievers, I'm talking Christians. I'm not pointing at any one person. I know of a lot who, you mentioned demons, they think there's a demon around every bush. They're everywhere around them. There was when my son attended Bible college, they had some guy talking about how every demons were everywhere. He had the demon of drink, he had the demon of this, a demon of that, and so on and so forth. And it got that. It was a Bible college class. A lot of the guys were just young Christians, and the girls were just like, is that true? What's going on? You know, my son, this is my oldest son, this is Robbie, and he did attend Bible college before he fell away, but he knew better. He's like, that's not true. They're not everywhere. Satan is not omnipresent.
No.
Okay? And every believer has angels about them protecting them. Okay?
Yeah.
Look at Job, good example. You know, Satan's saying, you got a hedge of protection around. Wonder nothing ever happens to him. Amen. And that's the point, is that we have a hedge of protection. Now, occasionally, bad things do happen. God allows them. And again, we know why. Just kind of test our faith. But don't sit there and also take them for granted, thinking, oh, I can push a demon around. You cannot. See, demons are spirit beings, and where you're more likely to run into them is when they possess a person. Christians can't be possessed. We have the Holy Spirit in us, so demon possession is impossible to a Christian, but oppression isn't. Demons can oppress you, and a lot of times try to neutralize you, either with fear or with the idea that you're alone, that God's abandoned you, even though you can feel it, no, he hasn't, but you know, there's that underlying thing. But when you run across a person who is in demon possession, it is probably going to be the scariest thing you've ever seen. And, you know, I never, as believe it or not, I never saw the movie The Exorcist. I heard all about it. And apparently there's a lot of truth in that movie, even though it came out of Hollywood. Okay? But to throw a demon out takes a special gift from a powerful Christian who has, his faith is staunch, has nothing hidden in his life in the way of hidden sin. Okay? And Jesus himself, of course, saying, hey, you know, demon come out, to quote Ernest Angsley from 40 years ago. And Jesus did. Don't try to deal with it on your own. We have a lot of that in this valley. Okay, we only have to drive down the road a little ways to know what I'm talking about, down Brooklyn Road. You're not going to get attacked or anything by driving down Brooklyn Road. It's a great shortcut to Elsinore, I don't know, I'll be honest with you. Yeah, I'm talking to you now. But as you go through there, pray. Pray the Lord that will reach that community, that little area.
Amen.
And say, Lord, by the power of Jesus Christ, cast those demons away. And the more you drive through there and do it, the more all of us drive through there and do it. Just drive. I didn't say stop. Just drive. The Lord's going to do a work there. And pretty soon we'll see the fruits of that work. It's going to be hard because it's going to be a hard battle, but that's the point. The demons have already lost. And Satan knows that, and what he's trying to do, because he knows the best way to hurt God is to take as many of us down to hell with him. He's going to try to make it appear like that he's won, when in fact he has not. Now, of course, a lot of people will look at Jesus and say, well, you know, the demon's screaming at you, you know. He said, well, you know, what do you want to do with us, Son of God? You know, and they're, you know, why do you shut him up? Well, you don't want Satan to be your PR person. Really what it boils down to. They knew this guy was demon-possessed. They knew demons came from Satan. So he's sitting there saying, oh yeah, you're the Son of God. That looks bad on Jesus. That's why you shut them up. You'll see that everywhere. You know, no. We don't care. You're done. That's why if you look all through the Gospels, every time the demons, they're begging and pleading, don't send us to the abyss. Don't send us ahead of our time. Okay? Most of them just said, shut up, go. Boom, they're gone. Okay? Jesus didn't want them to talk about it. That's a simple reason. There's no deep-seated conspiracy here. Jesus didn't want them to publicize it because that would destroy his own witness. He knew it. So, moving on, verse 38. Now he arose from the synagogue and entered Simon's, this is Peter, Simon's house. But Simon's wife's mother was sick with a high fever. Even the doctor Luke to mention the high fever. Okay. And they made request of him concerning her. So he stood over her and he rebuked the fever and it left her. And immediately she arose and served them. When the sun was setting, all those who had any that were sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. And more demons came out of many, crying out and saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of God." And he rebuked them, did not allow them to speak, for they knew that he was the Christ. Now when it was day, okay, this is the night, now it's daytime, the morning, he departed and went into a deserted place, and the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving. But he said to them, "I must preach the kingdom of God to the other cities also, because for this purpose I have been sent." And he was preaching in the synagogues of Galilee. Okay. So now, Jesus goes to Simon's home. Simon's mother-in-law is sick. And he heals her, okay? Once healed, she gets up to serve them. And it may seem like something remarkable. You were sick, now you're well, and what are you doing? Now, if you were anything like my grandmother was, she was that type of woman. She'd be on her sick bed and bemoaning the fact she couldn't serve the family. That was just her servant's heart. That's my daughter's name, said Emma Grace, okay, my grandma. It's very much, I could picture my grandmother doing this. But there's a difference here. It wasn't like she recovered after this long instance or illness. She was healed instantly. Up she goes, and now she's serving. Okay? There's a lesson here. Once we're saved, we should be immediately serving too. Okay? And I'm not saying you're not. But that should be the first impulse, is to, "Lord, what can I do for you? You saved me. You healed me from my sins. What can I do for you?"
Amen.
Okay? And so many times we see people who are healed, but they think they have to relax a bit, take it easy, and they have to build up their strength. But true healing through Christ, there's no need for that. The healing is complete, just like our forgiveness of sins is complete. Okay? We don't have to worry about, well, what can I do? I'll tell you. Okay? What can you do? Depends. Okay? Take out trash. Okay? It doesn't take a theology degree to do that. Okay? Mop the floors in the bathroom. It doesn't take much to do that. Help stack chairs. It takes a little bit of strength, but they're not that heavy. Okay? Lord's going to help you, and people in this church will do it. Okay? This is one of those times I know I'm speaking to the choir. We serve one another, and no excuse. God healed us. We're now serving. So now, it's after the Sabbath, sundown. And this is something a lot of people don't realize. Remember, he came from the synagogue. He came home, healed Peter's mother-in-law. And then, at sundown, everybody shows up at his doorstep for healing. And see, according to the law, the twisted law of the Pharisees, healing was only permissible when the Sabbath was over. You'd go out and pull a cow out of a ditch where you couldn't heal somebody. Something twisted about that. Okay? So they're coming up and they're asking for help. Jesus is healing them. He's silencing the demons. He's throwing them out. This was a long day. So he decides, "I need a little rest." And his way of rest was going out to a deserted place to pray. Okay? As we're going to see, this was how Jesus found his strength and power for service. We're going to see this over and over again. Jesus going out to just a deserted place. A place with no distractions and where it was quiet, where he and God could commune together and he could regain his spiritual power. Now again, we know Jesus was all God, all man, but he did it. How this all worked, God knows. Don't worry about it. Okay? Only God knows. That's enough for us. And it's a good example for us. Okay? We got wilderness all over the place, right? Go drive up Monroe Canyon. Get to the Monrovian Park and park there for a little bit. Just spend a little time. And I'll be honest with you, the best place to go, where there's no cell phone service. That way you're not constantly looking and saying, let me check Facebook real quick. Text from, There's no cell service, nothing happens. I know a lot of people use these for their Bibles, so I'm not saying, keep the thing at home. But just go someplace. There are lots of distractions. We need to make the time. Oh, I don't have the time to make it. Somewhere, some way, there is downtime that will allow you, even if it's just going into your backyard, away from the kids, or away from people, or away from friends, TV, shut off the cell phone. I can't tell you how much these things are distractions. Mm-hmm. Okay? And we know it. We can't seem to want to turn it off. You know it's true. You know it's true. Take the time. Jesus did. He went all sorts of places. That's kind of the cool thing, is it didn't matter. Get away from all the distractions. Enjoy God's nature. Be someplace. Be with him.
Yes.
So, we're at the end of the chapter. So, a couple of things for takeaways. Okay, we went through a lot, so I'm not going to take a lot more time. But first off, just speak the truth, even if you know there's going to be opposition. That's from, Jesus in the synagogue. He could have gave a very empty sermon that tickled the ears to everybody in there, but that wasn't Jesus. Jesus called a spade a spade, and we should too. People are not going to like the gospel message. People are offended by it. That's the point. They still need to hear it, though. All right?
Amen.
Serve the Lord in whatever way you can, despite the circumstances. Okay? A lot of people, I think I may have mentioned this elsewhere, but Corrie Ten Boom, toward the end of her life, she was bedridden. And she bemoaned the fact that she couldn't do anything anymore to serve the Lord. But her pastor basically said, oh yeah, you can. You can pray.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And suddenly she was brightened up, like, you're absolutely right. And so she was on that church's prayer chain. She got all the phone calls and she would pray for everything. She had a powerful prayer warrior to the end of her life. And she realized, even though I may not be able to do what I used to do, I can still pray.
Amen.
I can still do something. So despite the circumstances, you're always going to pray.
Amen.
And lastly, we just kind of went through it. Set aside that alone time with the Lord frequently and regularly. You can do it once a day, do it. If it means getting up an hour earlier to do it, do it. Okay? There's lots of ways. Driving to work, okay? You don't close your eyes when you're praying when you're on the highway, okay? You don't want to pull you out of the ditch. But pray, okay? I use that time, frankly, I listen to sermons on my radio, okay? And then before I go into the jail, I stop off over at Sevier Valley, the church, and I use my time to pray there. And yeah, I leave earlier than I need to. That's when I want to, because I need that time. Especially now, I need that time. Okay? Because the Lord, he's my strength, just like he's your strength as well. Get rid of the distractions. Take a special afternoon, maybe on a Saturday if you're not working or something. Go up into the mountains. Don't have to go too far, especially if you don't have a 4x4. You can just go up to, like I said, go up to Monrovian Park. It's a paved road. And just take some time. Lord, I'm here. What do you want from me? Karen, you're here in this natural church, this beautiful cathedral in the canyon. Lord, what you want? Let's talk. Let's get to know one another. Father, again, we thank you for this time we've had together. And Father, we just praise you. We give you all the glory. And we thank you for the example of Jesus in our lives, that we can look to him. We want to know how to be a Christian. All we have to do is look at Jesus. Yeah, we may not be able to, you know, raise people from the dead or anything like that, but there are small miracles that you perform for us, and help them to recognize those little miracles for what they are. Even if it's filling in when the paycheck goes out, or to, you know, helping someone, reaching out to them when they're sad and not knowing what to say, but you give us those words, Father. You help us along those lines. And those are many miracles in and of themselves. We thank you, Father, that you gave your life for us. We thank you that you loved us so much that you didn't want heaven without us. And so you gave your Son as a sacrifice for us, even when we didn't want it, didn't think about it. We think about the people in Nazareth at the synagogue. They didn't want to hear what your plan was because it didn't fit in with their plans. Help us not to be that. Help our plans to be your plans. Your will is our will. So, Father, give us all traveling mercies as we head home tonight. We ask you, Father, for a continued blessing over our church. Keep us all safe from illness and sickness and all harm. We praise you, Father, and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so next week, we continue into chapter 5. So, have a great weekend.
Good message. So I remember Isaiah 14 and Satan.